It's time to turn it over to one of the world's leading eclipse scientists to hear how she got into this field and how she goes about creating the beautiful images of the solar eclipse. Dr. Shadia Habbal is joining us all the way from Hawaii today. Over to you.
Good morning. My name is Shadia Habbal, and I'm professor of astronomy at the University of Hawaii, the Institute for Astronomy. What I'd like to talk to you today is how I got into eclipses and eclipse observations, and also the unique science that we can get out of eclipses and their value. So the way I started is, it was around 1993 or 4. I was doing modeling of the solar wind. And then we always had this one parameter that we needed to know, which was the electron temperature. So I came across, I was very much aware of eclipse observations, but I hadn't appreciated how important they were for getting the physical parameters of the corona. So I decided that maybe we should try an eclipse observation. And at the time, digital cameras had just started to come on the market, and I figured these were easy to take to eclipses. So I submitted a proposal to NASA, and we got started this way. So we went to India in 1995, and that was my first eclipse, and it was 42 seconds long. Nevertheless, it was one of the most beautiful ones, and we got some nice data. Observing during eclipses becomes an addiction when you realize that you can do better, you can improve on your instrumentation, and you can get some really very important information. So it was in 2006 that in Libya that we discovered, we got the first image of the corona in a color, which corresponds to iron that has been had lost 10 of its electrons. And the image was quite surprising. And so what I'd like to describe today is what I call the colors of the corona. Because during, just going back to when people, before photography, people would draw the details they saw in images, and these details were exquisite. But when, with the advent of photography, one could tell that the images were okay. They were captured, but they were missing the fine details that one could see with the eye. Nevertheless, we proceeded, and one fact I need to bring out is that after photography, there was also the discovery of the spectrometer. And it was during the eclipse of 1869 that people discovered one spectral line, a color green, that they didn't know what it corresponded to. And it wasn't until 70 years later that from theoretical calculations and laboratory experiments, that Grotrian and Edlin realized that this was iron that had lost 13 of its electrons, meaning that the corona, or the medium where it was coming from, was at least at a million degrees. So the implications were significant, and I think this is the start of our space exploration, because one, it meant this very hot corona meant that it could not remain bound to the sun. Therefore, there was a stream of particles that Parker called the solar wind. In addition, at this temperature implied that the corona could emit in the extreme ultraviolet and X-rays, and that it could be actually observed from space. And this was the launch of the space age. But the most important for us is really the fact that the solar wind, which is the stream of particles from the sun out into space, is the cause of the aurorae, and it's also the cause of some of the beautiful iron tails of comets. Now, one would wonder why in this age of space exploration, why is it that we still want to use eclipses to observe the sun? Well, it's by looking at images, for example, in the extreme ultraviolet, where one can see the disk of the sun or the surface directly looking down at the sun, and also some of the extension of the emission of the edge, one realizes that this emission cuts off very quickly. And compared to an eclipse image, you can see much further away from the sun from the eclipse. Now, Leo had, in the 1930s, had invented a coronagraph, which was a man-made occulter, which mimicked the effect of an eclipse. And so it blocked the disk of the sun, and one could see the corona. So with a man-made coronagraph, you can see, you can block the disk of the sun, and you can see the corona, except that its extent is not as far out as what you see during a total solar eclipse. And the other limitation is the fact that this man-made disk covers a little bit more than just past the perimeter of the sun. Now, from space, the coronagraphs, the one that's been operating since 1995, LASCO C2, it's been extremely valuable for giving data, you know, continuously over time. So we see all the dynamic events in the corona. But what's happening is a significant part of the corona starting from the solar surface out to a few out to a radius above the surface is all missing. And this is where the eclipse observations come in. Now, I mentioned earlier that with the advent of photography, what was kind of disappointing is that you capture an image of the sun within total solar eclipse, except you really don't capture all the fine details on camera that you get with your eye. And this is where people started to work on developing image processing techniques. And one of the most remarkable techniques were developed by Professor Druckmüller, who's in University of Brno University in the Czech Republic. So with this, with the image processing, then you can retrieve all the details you see in the eclipse images. And when we compare these images with what one gets from space, for example, from the extreme ultraviolet, then the match is actually astounding. And we have an example from the eclipse of 2015, where it was at the beginning of the launch of STO, and we could compare image, the extreme ultraviolet image, and match it to the coronal image from the eclipse. And the extent showed where how things at the sun started and how they expanded into interplanetary space or much further away from the sun. So I want to go back now to the question of what kind of science we're doing. And I mentioned that we're trying to capture the colors of the corona. Now, if you recall, we talked about the importance of the discovery of the green line. And it turns out that in addition to protons and electrons that are the most dominant particles in the corona, you also have trace elements. From the most abundant is iron, but you have oxygen, nickel, argon, you name it. There are plenty, all the elements are there in the corona. And they produce, each one of them has a specific color or wavelength or frequency at which it likes to emit. So what we try to do is to probe deeper into the physics of the corona, is to try to capture these different colors or that these different elements are emitting. So what we've done so far is try to focus on the iron spectral iron element, because it produces different spectral lines or different colors. So from these colors, we were able to discover that the corona is dominated by the emission that corresponds to two different temperatures. One is around 1,000,000 degrees and the other is around 2,000,000 degrees. And this everything that streams away from the sun seems to be at the cooler temperature. So in a way, it's giving us an answer to what I had originally started to look for, which is the electron temperature. However, what we noticed is that when we take eclipse observations as a function of time, we see that the distribution of these colors or this emission changes because the corona changes as a function of time. The other important thing that we discovered is that with the, for example, not only can we look at the distribution of the emission, but we can also tell something about whether these ions or these particles, if they're moving in the corona, how fast they're moving. And in 2015, it was the first time that we captured a whole coronal mass ejection front with different bits of it traveling away from the observer at speeds ranging from 100 to 1500 kilometers per second. What was even more exciting was that some of these bits had with them, these very, very hot bits of 2 million degrees, had with them very, very cool material, which is characteristic of prominences. And prominences are these cool features, cool in temperature, and are usually bound to the sun. But when they erupt, they form, they produce, or they trigger these coronal mass ejections. So what we found is that we just captured in the image the bits of these very dense and cool material embedded within this huge and very, very hot temperature front. So the equipment we use to gather these observations are rather simple. They're cameras, and we have cameras which are retrofitted with special filters to isolate the emission from the different iron lines or anything else. And also we have a spectrometer. Now, because we go to different places around the world, we try to keep the equipment light enough or compact enough so that we can easily transport it. And most of the optics we carry with us on the plane in backpacks. So now with this upcoming eclipse in August of this year, there's an incredible opportunity to have different observing sites along the path of totality. And this would give us more chances to beat weather, to guarantee that we get data, because these observations can only be made maybe every once a year or every 18 months. And because they're so unique, we want to capitalize on every single opportunity we can to get these observations. So the best sites are towards the western part of the United States. And so this is where we will be going. And I hope that as many people as possible, regardless whether they're scientists or just any person, will try to get to the center line to observe this gorgeous phenomenon.
Thanks, Shadia, and hopefully you have a great observing session during the eclipse this year. So that's it for this month. We hope that you found this useful. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to post them below. If you have anything specific that you'd like us to cover in one of our webcasts, please get in touch with us. You can email us directly at outreach@nso.edu. You can post your suggestions below the videos. You can get us on Twitter at @NatSolarObs or on Facebook at facebook.com/National Solar Observatory. And we have a new Instagram account, and our Instagram handle is @National Solar Observatory. So please get in touch, let us know what you think of the videos, if you have any questions, if you'd like us to cover anything specific, and we hope that you'll join us next month.